Hello everyone, I am S.S. Tilakaratna from the intermediate year. In this video clip, I will be discussing the concept of constitutionalism. From 2016 to date, students have been frequently tested on this area. So it is important for us to learn about this concept so as to write a proper answer at the examination. Generally, students are required to analyze this concept with reference to principles of constitutionalism or with reference to rule of law and separation of powers. By the end of this video clip, you will learn how to provide a proper introduction to this concept as well as to analyze it. Before we analyze this concept, we should know what is the difference between the Constitution and this concept of constitutionalism. Constitution, according to our preamble, it states that it is the supreme law of the state. So then what is constitutionalism? Constitutionalism is purely a concept. It is a derivative of our constitution. So it is evident that the concept of constitutionalism cannot exist if there is no constitution. So now let's attempt to provide a brief definition to this concept. We can say that the concept of constitutionalism explains the objectives of a good constitution. Now the question arises, what makes a constitution good? Our Sri Lankan constitution, for example, it properly divides institutional powers and demarcates their legal boundaries and legal jurisdictions. You can see our Article 4, there it is stated that the three main organs of the government are judiciary, executive and the legislature. Before moving on to giving an introduction to the concept of constitutionalism, we must know what is rule of law and separation of powers. Because in a good constitution, there is rule of law and separation of powers. Rule of law can be briefly stated as no individual, whether he is rich, poor, ruler or ruled, is above the law. He cannot go beyond the law. He should obey the law. But the modern view of rule of law is different. According to Dilley Declaration, as you see on the screen, it states that the rule of law implies that the functions of the government in a free society should be so exercised as to create conditions in which the dignity of man as an individual is upheld. This dignity requires not only the recognition of certain civil and political rights, but also creation of certain political, social, economical and cultural conditions which are essential to the full development of his personality. For an example, our 1972 constitution recognizes fundamental rights, but there was no mechanism to enforce them. But in our 1978 constitution, it recognizes fundamental rights as well as it provides a mechanism to enforce them. So it is clear that from the definition in the modern sense to rule of law, it says that it is not merely recognizing these rights, but also creating conditions for these rights. Now we must know what separation of powers means. According to Article 4, it clearly states the three main organs of the government: legislature, executive and the judiciary respectively. Legislature makes laws, executive enforces them and the judiciary interprets them. Separation of powers means these three organs must not encroach onto the functions of each other. That means, for an example, the judiciary must not do the task of the executive, so as the executive should not do the tasks of the judiciary. Now look at Article 4. In Article 4C, it states that the judicial power of the people shall be exercised by Parliament. During the Divinagum hearing before the Supreme Court, the Parliament contended that the bill is not unconstitutional because the Parliament is supreme. The Parliament raised this argument because of Article 4C. But it was said that this article should not be read in isolation. It should be read with the conditional clause there. So what is the conditional clause in this article? The conditional clause is, through courts, tribunals and institutions created and established or recognized by the Constitution or established by law. So bearing these two concepts in our mind, now we can move to provide a broader definition for the concept of constitutionalism. According to the American constitutional theorist Carl Friedrich, he says that, as you see on the screen, the core objective of constitutionalism is that of safeguarding each member of the political community as a political person possessing a sphere of genuine autonomy. The constitution is meant to protect the self in its dignity and worth. The prime function of a constitutional political order has been and is being accomplished by means of a system of regularized restraints imposed upon those who wield political power. So as you can see in this definition, we can identify two vital elements. The first one is promoting individual autonomy, and the second one is limiting government authority. And before analyzing these two elements, we must know what is individual autonomy and what is imposing limitations on government authority. Individual autonomy can be stated as, if a person can live his own life according to his own wishes, reasons or motives, we can say that that person possesses individual autonomy. Now, what is imposing limitations on government authority? According to our Article 4, it clearly states out that legislature, executive and the judiciary are the three main organs of the government. So the constitution itself imposes limitations on these three institutions. So what you can see in this definition is that the concepts of rule of law and separation of powers are impliedly recognized in this definition. That is why I discussed them before. So now I must say that the concept of constitutionalism cannot exist if there is no constitution, and it also cannot exist if there is no rule of law and separation of powers in a state. Now let's move on to our analysis. According to Article 83, it lays down a special procedure in regard to certain bills. It requires, in addition, 2/3 majority in a bill in order to become law must have approval at referendum. This article clearly limits government authority. It imposes limitations on parliament because it clearly states that to become law, the bill must get approval from the people at a referendum. Now have a look at Article 46, paragraph 2. It states that the president no longer has the power to remove the prime minister at his discretion. Now this article clearly limits the power of the president. I'll provide you an example. In 2018 October, Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe claimed that the removal from his office by the president was unconstitutional with reference to this section. Now let's move on to an article which falls into both these categories, that is promoting individual autonomy as well as limiting government authority. According to Article 43, paragraph 2 and Article 44, paragraph 1, it states that the president is required to act on the advice of the prime minister when appointing or removing from office any cabinet minister, non-cabinet minister or deputy minister. Now, why this falls into promoting individual autonomy? For that, we must look at Article 44, paragraph 2. According to Article 44, paragraph 2, the president appoints the prime minister and he shall appoint as the prime minister a member of parliament who, in his opinion, is most likely to command the confidence in the parliament. So as we saw in Article 4, it is the people who send their representatives to the parliament. So by Article 43, paragraph 2 and 44.1, the president is required to act on the advice of the prime minister means the president is required to act on the wishes of the people because the prime minister is sent to the parliament by the people. Now, why this article limits government authority? We can clearly say that the article limits the power of the president by subjecting him to the advice of the prime minister. Now let's move on to Article 35, paragraph 1. This falls into limiting president's powers. According to this article proviso, it states that provided that nothing in this paragraph shall be read and construed as restricting the right of any person to make an application under 126 against the Attorney General in respect of anything done or omitted to be done by the president in his official capacity. Suppose that the president, acting at his official capacity, prevents a person from returning to Sri Lanka. Now, this is a fundamental rights infringement under Article 14, paragraph 1I. So, that aggrieved person, according to this article, file a fundamental rights petition against the Attorney General. So, it is clear that this article limits the power of the President. Now, have a look at clause 9 of the 19th Amendment. It repeals the previous Article 44, paragraph 2. Prior to the 19th Amendment, the President could assign to himself or herself subject of function not assigned to any other cabinet minister. So by the repeal of this provision, it is clear that the President's power is limited. Now there's another important article, that is Article 41A, paragraph 1. This makes provision for the establishment of the Constitutional Council. According to Article 41B, paragraph 1, as you see on the screen, for these commissions, the President must act on the recommendations of the Constitutional Council. So that means without the recommendation of the Constitutional Council, the President cannot appoint members to these commissions. That means it's an article which limits the President's powers. A similar article is Article 41B, paragraph 3. It also limits President's powers by making him to act on the recommendation of the Constitutional Council in appointing chairmen for these commissions. According to Article 41C, paragraph 1, it makes provisions for the Constitutional Council to approve the nominees of the President for the positions you see on the screen. For an example, the President cannot make an appointment if his nomination is not approved by the Constitutional Council. That's what this article says. So it is clear that this article also limits President's powers. Now there's an interesting fact. That means the Constitution itself imposes limitations on the Constitutional Council as well. According to Article 41E, paragraph 4 and paragraph 5, the Council should endeavor to make every recommendation, approval or decision it is required to make by unanimous decision. Where unanimous decision is not possible, no recommendation, approval or decision made by the Council shall be valid, unless supported by no less than 5 members of the Council present at such meeting. So this also limits the authority or the power of the Constitutional Council. Now have a look at Article 41(9). It states that all decisions, approvals and recommendations made by the Council are final and can only be challenged in the court of law by a fundamental rights application in terms of Article 126. Now this article promotes individual autonomy. What's the reason? For an example, suppose that the Constitutional Council made a decision depriving the ideal candidate to that position. Now, according to this article, that aggrieved party can file a fundamental rights application under this article. So that means by the Constitution, the individual autonomy is of that aggrieved person is upheld. Now have a look at Article 41B, paragraph 6. It provides that all commissions referred to in schedule to this article other than the election commission shall be responsible and answerable to Parliament. That means these commissions are responsible and answerable to Parliament, which means their powers are limited by the Constitution. Now we have two articles that falls into both categories. According to Article 104B, paragraph 4 and paragraph 5, the election commission has the power to prevent the political party in government from using state resources, including state broadcasters, for their election campaign. This article, on one hand, promotes individual autonomy. So you can analyze it by looking at Article 4. And on the other hand, it limits government authority. That means it imposes regulations on the political party who are going to use state resources by giving the election commissions the power to prevent them. According to Article 70, paragraph 1, it removes the President's power to dissolve Parliament in his own discretion. This article also limits President's authority as well as promotes individual autonomy. Why this article promotes individual autonomy is that it is the people who send their representatives to the Parliament. So now the President cannot act at his own discretion in derogation of the people's wishes. And why this falls into limiting President's powers? It is clear from this article that President cannot, as he wishes, dissolve Parliament. He has to act in the manner stated as in this article. Now, another article which is important is Article 14A of the Constitution. It provides that inclusion of right to access information as provided for by law. For an example, if a citizen of the country wants to know about the protection of his rights, according to this article, he has the right to access such information at a government department or any ministry or the state. In concluding this video clip, I must say that we made an attempt to give a proper definition to the concept of constitutionalism, and then we found or we identified two vital elements in this concept, and then we analyzed these two elements with reference to constitutional provisions. So I believe that now you understand what the concept of constitutionalism means, and now you have an idea how to provide an appropriate answer when it is required at the examination to analyze this concept with reference to constitutional provisions. So we'll see you in another video clip. Thank you very much.